afternoon and welcome to Future Stars. Thanks to the Builders Academy Australia. This is the best week in football, the lead up to the grand final, everything that goes along with it. And as always, there is going to be a lot of talk around player movement. This is the Builders Academy Australia Future Stars show, and we're going to tell you exactly where they might go. We're going to give you a mock draft. Cal Toomey is going to say the top 18 in the draft as they will be selected on draft night. Dylan Shiel, where's he going? We'll talk about that. And well done to the Dandenong Stingrays, who are the TAC Cup Grand Final champions as of yesterday. As I worked my way around the panel, and last week this man had to scoot off a little bit early because he was playing in the Premier League final and he needed to get there because he was the star of the show to get him into the grand final. I've been busting to wait to see how they went.
You just told me you weren't going to ask me about this.
No, I changed my mind. How did you go?
We went terrible, and my preparation stood up, and I was terrible as well, Brownie.
So. I thought your preparation being in here before a prelim was going to be a bit of a stretch.
No, I wasn't on my own, though. I did have a few teammates in the same...
You're going to lag into all your teammates,
yeah,
too.
Because I wasn't good and they weren't good, so it's not good enough.
And Cal Toomey, the top 18 of the draft. That's pretty exciting.
Yeah, looking forward to that one. Was at the TAC Cup Grand Final yesterday, which you mentioned before. Oakley Chargers came home really strong, but Dandenong Stingrays secure their first ever premiership after a few attempts, so congratulations to them.
And not far away, Riley West, the son of former Bulldogs champion, seven-time best and fairest winner, must be said, Scotty West. He's going to join us over at the McCafe to talk about potentially a move to the father-son Dogs next year as we head into the Kangan Institute Trade Centre. Kangan Institute, bound to industry, bound to succeed. Visit kangan.edu.au. Dylan Shiel is on everybody's lips at the moment. Is he going to be a player outside of GWS? Because he didn't say in his exit interview that he wanted a trade.
No, not yet. He met with the club this week. His manager, Paul Connors, obviously said this week as well that it was still up in the air. I expect some more clarity on his situation in the next week or so. It's an interesting one, though, isn't it, guys? Because we hear so much about how tight their salary cap is. Is he the right one to go, though? Because in my opinion, they could open up $700,000 worth of space if they move Rory Lobb on. They open up a bit more if they move Will Setterfield to a Victorian club. Jeremy Finlayson, they're open to moving on as well. There's other ways to get around the salary cap squeeze. I think they have to keep on a Shield as much as they can.
Finlayson just signed a couple of months ago, I think, and now he's asking for a trade, potentially. I think they've got to do everything they can to keep Dylan Shiel. I think he's one of the elite midfielders in the competition and he shouldn't be squeezed out.
In your opinion, does he want to be squeezed out? Is it an easy out for him if they say to him, look, we will entertain offers? Does he want to leave or does he want to stay?
I think he's making that decision up at the moment.
I think by this stage you've made a decision.
You think? Yeah. Well, I mean,
like Andrew Gaff, I think Andrew Gaff's made a decision, but out of respect for the West Coast Eagles, he's going to make that decision and tell everybody about it next week.
Well, I guess in the next couple of weeks, she'll have to work out if he has made that decision where he wants to go, because obviously he's got some suitors, Carlton, Essendon, St Kilda are throwing big money at him, Hawthorn as well. For the Giants' sake, maybe they just say, no, you're contracted. You're contracted for another year. We need you next year. We need to go really hard
What's
at the flag.
What's he worth? Oh. Because you're talking Pollock 750. Chad Wingard reported $1 million, which I think is irresponsible. Dylan Shiel, what's he worth?
You'd have to be somewhere in between $800,000 and $900,000. Thereabouts for me. Yep. Are you saying that Andrew Gaff's made up his mind to leave the West Coast out of respect, not announcing it? Are you saying that he's made the decision to go?
I just don't see holding on this long how the decision would be. I might be wrong. The decision would be, I'm going to stay. Wouldn't that buoy you going into the grand final to say, yeah, I've made my decision, I'm going to stay? The longer it goes, the longer for me it seems like that he'll be out.
Yeah, one would certainly think that makes a lot of sense.
Also, Aaron Hall, potentially to the Kangaroos. This guy had 9 Brownlow votes last year in rounds 1, 2 and 3, so he can genuinely play. He's been pretty ordinary the back half of this year, but certainly for the Kangaroos, this is a man they need to get.
A couple of coaches haven't been able to get the best out of him. Maybe Brad Scott's the man. He met with the Roos this week, as did Nick Newman from the Swans Boomer. So a couple of other guys to go with. Joe Pollock, who expect to go there. Brownie expects Andrew Gaff to be on the move. He looks like going to North Melbourne if he does change clubs. It's a pretty good haul if they can bring them all together.
It's a good off-season, isn't it? If they can land Gaff, Pollock, Hall and maybe a Nick Newman, a kicker, a running back, it's a pretty good off-season.
Do you think it's what they need? Because
They do need outside. I've mentioned it before. Dumont's come on in leaps and bounds. You've got Cunnington in there, of course. Yep. Zeeble can play through the middle. They need outside run. If they can land two or three of them, they're
going to
be...
Higgins is probably more inside than outside these days. Like, he does finish
well. Yeah, he does a little bit of both.
Yeah. Yep. What do you think when you think about Scotty West? You played a lot of footy against him?
Yeah, absolutely. I've actually played in a state game with him as well, which was fantastic.
No, need to pump yourself up. We're talking about Scotty West.
You mentioned 7-time best and fairest, and that always seems to pop up. To win a best and fairest, Brownie, you've got to be pretty good. You got one of them, didn't you?
Without Yeah, came second a couple of times. but the most prepared player I ever played with, Scotty West. We're going to speak to his son straight after the break over at the McCafe. His name is Riley West, a potential top 20 pick, probably going to the Dogs as a father's son. That's up next on Future Stars. Welcome back to Future Stars. Thanks to the Builders Academy Australia. Become a building legend with Builders Academy Australia. Riley West, potential father's son, is over at the McCafe. Try McCafe's brand new McCoffee. Smooth, refined and delicious. Riley, welcome, mate. It must be an interesting time, a nervous time for you because you've got the draft combine in a couple of weeks.
Yeah, I mean, definitely it's a big time in under, like when you're an 18-year-old footballer with the draft and the combine and even school for a lot of us. So, yeah, a bit of pressure, but sure we can all handle it.
I used to remember when you were about 3 or 4 years old, running around the house, kicking footies, knocking over things, fighting your brothers. The old man, he's obviously been a big influence.
Yeah, definitely. He's definitely my number one coach in footy. I've had a lot of different coaches, but, you know, he's just got the main message for me all the time. So, yeah, it's been a great influence. And obviously, he's been a great player, so makes it even better.
Have you rated your season, Rolly? You were named an All-Australian at the Championships, playing some really good footy for Vic Metro. How have you seen it?
Yeah, I thought I had a pretty consistent year, just finding the footy and trying to get my teammates into the game. So, yeah, I thought it's a good consistent year and played the same level of footy over all the different teams I played for.
You mentioned it's a pretty nervous year for you. You're completing year 12 as well, playing under 18 football. There's been a lot of debate about the draft age. What do you reckon it would be better for next year? You concentrate on your school this year and then try to get drafted next year, or it's all combined into one and it works well for you?
Yeah, I guess going to school, it gives you a little bit of time to, I don't know how to explain it. Like, you have something occupied to do, whereas you're not sitting around doing nothing all day. And I don't know, as long as it's 18 this year, I don't really mind if it changes.
Tell us about your involvement with the Dogs and the father-son program and what they've told you about their interest levels.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, they've had their programs where I've gone down for a few days and stuff, and hopefully have a meeting soon to, you know, gather where they're at and see what happens with the where I get picked or if I get picked. And yeah.
Any guarantees?
I don't know. I have to ask them. Yeah.
Well, we got Cal's draft coming up, mock draft. I'm going to put you on the spot. Give us your 1, 2, and 3 in this year's draft.
Probably have to go 1 Sammy Walsh, 2 Jack Lukosius, and 3 Isaac Rankin.
Oh, very nice work. Hey, we've got a photo here of you running out with your old man in the 300th. There you are. You're looking a little bit sheepish. What's going on? Do you remember that day?
That was in Perth, I'm pretty sure.
Yep.
In Perth. And I've got a little photo of it when I walk into my room and it's on my wall. So, yeah, I remember that. It was a bit special. So, yeah.
Hey, have you done the sums of how you get to the Dogs? If Dalhouse does go to Geelong, potential to get an extra pick at the end of the first round, maybe second round that they could use for you on that?
Not really. I mean, it's not really my thing to worry about. It's sort of just wait till the draft and I guess, yeah, see what they can do. It's not really my business to, you know, shuffle their cards.
Well, I reckon hopefully all the Dog supporters out there want you to get to the Dogs. And thanks very much for joining us here today, mate.
Thank you.
You don't leave empty-handed. You've got a lot of prizes. The Dometic 43-litre ice box valued at $239. Dometic mobile living made easy. That's what all the boys come around. Thanks to Macca's, a $50 McCafe voucher. Head in to taste the new McCafe blend, 100% Arabica beans. And McCafe, we are coffee people in the Melbourne Parkview Hotel. Rediscover the Melbourne Parkview Hotel from $169 per couple. Riley West, good luck, mate.
Thank you.
Riley West, potential father-son to the Dogs. Let's have a look at the Advanced Hair Recruit of the Week. Advanced Hair, Australia's largest and renowned hair restoration clinic, scientifically proven, medically backed hair loss treatment. So these are some of the guys we've featured this year, Kel.
Yeah, and he's the rising star. He's the obvious one. He's one of the goals of the year from Jack Higgins. He was great on Friday night again. He's been a star. But not only draftees, recruits as well, because Devin Smith's probably the pickup of the year.
Oh, he's certainly been the pickup of the year. Led the tackles by an absolute mile. The way he goes about his football, you can see that he's going to be a future star, if not already.
Now, time for the Multicultural Player of the Week for Tobin Brothers Funeral Celebrating Lives. And earlier in the week, I caught up with Adam Sard, our Multicultural Player of the Year.
We've had some great nominees for the Multicultural Player of the Week this year. We've had Christian Petrarca, Dion Prestia. But the winner of the Multicultural Player of the Year, brought to you by Tobin Brothers Funeral Celebrating Lives, is Essendon's Adam Saad. And Adam, congratulations on you. You've won $2,500 courtesy of Tobin Brothers Funerals and also another $2,500 that you're going to donate to the Homeless Aid. Firstly, tell us about your season, your first at the Bombers.
Yeah, thanks for that. Really appreciate that. First year at the club, we just missed out on finals. So hopefully we can build on that and, you know, improve on that result next year. Personally, I've built throughout the season. I've really, really enjoyed my time at the club.
Tell us about you picked a charity, Homeless Aid. What's your involvement with them and how much time have you spent with them?
Yeah, so Homeless Aid's been happening for the last 5 years. It's every Tuesday, helps the homeless, brings them food, feeds them, and, you know, we provide them with clothes as well. So I've been doing it for the last couple of weeks and I've really enjoyed my time just to see how much of a difference you bring to people's lives, and Homeless Aid have done an incredible job and they're going to strive to keep doing that in the near future.
And James McLeod from Tobin Brothers Funerals, you must be pretty proud of your involvement and Adam's year as well.
Yeah, congratulations, Adam.
Thank you, mate.
On everyone at Tobin Brothers Funerals. We're delighted to be involved with Future Stars and this award each and every year. Tobin Brothers has been around since 1934, serving multicultural Melbourne, and it's fantastic that there's so many great multicultural players playing AFL today, and Adam is a very worthy recipient, and I think it's fantastic the charity that he's chosen also, and good on you for that great work that you're doing with that charity each and every week, Adam.
Thank
and congratulations from all of us at Tobin Brothers.
Thank you.
Thanks, Adam. Thanks, James. And that's it for the Multicultural Player of the Year award for this year.
Welcome back to Future Stars, thanks to the Builders Academy Australia. As you see the footy on the desk there. Now, Blue Ribbon Day is a very, very important day, as we know, on the calendar. 159 lives have been lost upholding the Victoria Police Oath of Service. So, next week across the country, please give generously at your local Woolworths, Australia Post or at remember.org.au. It is a great thing to give to for all our police and we thank you very much on Blue Ribbon Day. Now, the Builders Academy Under 18 Team of the Year. Let's go over to Kel.
Thanks, Brandy and Boomer. One change for the final team of the year. So this is the Under 18s Team of the Year, the final one. Riley Collier-Dawkins comes into the side after a great final series. So this is what we've settled on. It's been a few changes throughout the season, but there's some really good players in this crew. So Riley Collier-Dawkins played for the Oakley Chargers yesterday. Here's some vision of him. He's a big-bodied midfielder, 194 centimetres, averaged about 21 touches throughout the final series for the Chargers. So as someone who can also push forward as well, given his size, 194 centimetres, as I said. So he comes into the side and probably starts forward switching with one of these great midfielders. I just like the way he can find the footy in close. And I think he goes somewhere in the first round on draft night.
Collier and we had Dawkins. Him on the show earlier on in the year. Nice young man.
He is. And he's impressed clubs with his character as well. So that's obviously a really important thing when you're assessing these players. So that's the team of the year. And congratulations to all the boys who made it. I'm sure it means plenty to them.
Well, here it is. This is not the mock draft. This is the official draft. Cal Toomey has said this will be verbatim. 1, 2, 3 in order. This will happen draft day. So if you're a potential draftee out there, you've got to listen up.
Yeah, this is. We'll start from the back end of the first round. So I'll start at 18 because we just mentioned
Riley Collier-Dawkins. You're working your way down, you're trying to say.
That's what we're doing. Riley Collier-Dawkins to the Suns, Liam Stockyer to the reigning premiers, the Tigers, Zach Butters, a midfielder from Western Jets. Ian Hill's a prospect who I think would inject great
You've
pace.
You've been off Ian Hill all year. I'm a bit surprised he's not higher.
He hasn't had a great year. But he finished with injury. So
15, we'll... no, Cal. He would have been a little bit higher
at the start of the year. He was in the top five at the start of the year, but injury hurt him and form as well. Curtis Taylor, a half forward. John Clark at 13 there for the Cats. He's a halfback from WA. He uses the ball really well. We've got Isaac Quaynor there. So the Pies have moved up to match the Geelong bid for him, the Oakley Chargers prospect, and Jackson Hatley as well at pick 11, the local boy for Port Adelaide.
All right, top 10, let's get into it.
10-4, Tyrant Thomas. I still think he goes around that mark for the Roos matching Port Adelaide's bid. Jai Caldwell is a midfielder from the Murray Bush Rangers, Bendigo Pioneers, and really good season for him towards the end of the season. Nick Blakey, he matches the Swans bid there, so the Bombers bid, Swans come up and get him. Connor Rosie, who we've loved in the second half of the season, played some great sample footy. He's at 7 for the Crows. They get a local boy there. Bailey Smith's a perfect fit for the Dogs. Inside, outside, powerful midfielder with pace. Ben King, Freo finally get a big key position player with a top 5 pick. And Isaac Rankin would offer some real pace, a genuine zip to what the Lions have. We've seen what he's done throughout the year. We had him on the show early in the season as well. He's just got some star quality. He loves the big stage. I think he wants to be one of the all-time greats. I think he believes he can be one of the all-time greats.
It's fair to say you had him 10 to 20 at the start of the year, and that's how good his year's been.
Oh, I think he was sort of always around the mark to be a top 10 pick. But look, his sample footy, he's played some great stuff at senior level as well. And again, as we saw during the championships, dominated there for South Australia.
Jai Caldwell?
Yeah, he's an interesting one because he has had some injuries throughout the season, hamstring problems, ended his season with another hamstring strain. But
he's from Bendigo, you're up.
Yeah, he's from Bendigo, and he's a good user of the footy. Essendon need a midfielder, so he's the man for them.
And the Super 7, as you call it, Cal?
Yes.
Connor Rosie sneaks in.
Well, Blakey's just in there, isn't he? He sort of counts, he sort of doesn't. So it's become the Elite Eight, I think. We've added Connor Rosie to that, his second half of the season.
Give us the top three.
Top three. You can't go wrong with these guys. Once you've got Sam Walsh at pick one, Jack Lukosius at pick two, and Max Hing at pick three. So Max Hing been doing a lot of his knee reconstruction rehab at the Saints throughout the season. He's worked really closely with them. Sam Walsh, we see here, the best midfielder in it, the best midfielder to come through the draft since Josh Kelly in 2013. So he's someone who you can just bank on playing 200 games. And Jack Lukosius as well, a key forward from South Australia.
So even with a knee reco, you've got Max ahead of his brother Ben?
Yeah, I think he's slightly ahead of him. Yep. I just think he's probably got more star factor and probably a little bit better in the air, I think, competitively. We see his marking here early in the season before he went down with that injury. So, look, there's not much splitting the top group, but I think Sam Walsh's season and consistency and leadership and character and all that makes him the perfect number one pick.
Cal, just on that, a lot of people just say pick the best player. If you weren't Carlton, you didn't need a midfielder, would you take Lukosius in front of Walsh? Is it that close or is he just a clear
I think he's gone ahead. I think he's gone ahead in terms of talent as well and in terms of performance. So Lukosius' season has been okay, but I think Walsh has been really good.
Yeah, nice work, the top 18 draft. Well done again, Cal Toomey. But I reckon you need a little bit of work on your cheque holding. I just noticed something in the last segment as we have a look at the way you're holding the cheque. You're not sure whether to give it to Adam Sard. You're not sure whether... He's not taking it. And then you're all sort of a little bit out on your own there.
He took it home, but he wouldn't take it on screen. So I'm a bit more comfortable at this plasma than that one.
Well done, Cal Toomey. And you need some work on your cheque holding. We'll be back after the break with Future Stars. Thanks to the Builders Academy Australia. Figurines there. Head to Mini Figurine, MiniLeague.com to order yours now to Dagoe up against Alex Rance. Who won that battle, Boomer?
Oh, I think we know the answer for that, Nathan.
Oh, Dagoe, they are on fire at the moment, the Pies. And MiniLeague.com, every player in the AFL available. They are fantastic work. Now, it's time for the Trade Predictor, thanks to Sheen Panel Service. When the unexpected happens on the road, choose Sheen Panel Service as your repairer. SheenGroup.com.au. Now, Tim Kelly, unbelievable player, mature age recruit. We've spoken a lot about him this year. Potentially maybe wants to go back to either Western Australia to go to the Dockers or the West Coast Eagles. How does that happen?
I'll go first. If he gets to the Eagles, Cal, obviously Tim Kelly goes to the West Coast Eagles. Geelong will receive West Coast Eagles' future first round pick, which they're playing in the grand final this year, so you'd think they'd have a pretty good year next year, which will be 15 plus, one would think.
We would say they'd offer this year's first round pick, but they don't have one, so they've given that one away. However, they could get a free agency compensation pick for Andrew Gaff if he goes, which would be around 18 or 19.
And Brownie thinks he's gone.
Well, he does.
Billy Brownless has convinced Tim Kelly staying.
Yeah,
at least Geelong.
Yeah, I think he's going to weigh things up in the next few weeks. He's spending some time in Geelong with his family and seeing how he sort of settles in just without footy around. So he only moved, his family only moved there in February with him. So
23? Is he 23 years old?
Yeah, and he's had a great year, hasn't he? So you can see why clubs are going for him. But the Dockers will also be interested in him because he's a WA boy, as we mentioned. So in this case, Kelly goes to the Dockers. The Cats receive Sean Darcy, their ruckman, and Fremantle's third round pick. So Sean Darcy is 20 years old. He's played seven games this year. Played really well last year when he was filling in for Aaron Sandilands. Geelong need a ruckman, don't they, Boomer? So it's not a bad one to go for.
It's not a bad one, but I think Tim Kelly's nearly in the elite bracket of AFL midfielders now. Is that enough? A future third-round pick, I think it will be, if they haven't got one this year, which I don't think they do. Sean Darcy, yes, they do need a ruckman. Is there a better ruckman out there? I'm not sure about this one.
Yeah, OK. Well, I think that he's quality, but I believe that Sean Darcy can be an all-time... Not an all-time, but one of the best ruckmen... One of the best ruckmen in the competition.
Polly Farmer.
I'll take that back. One of the best ruckmen in the competition. What we've seen so far is really impressive, and I think the Cats would do with him really well.
Well, let's head towards the grand final and the Toyota AFL grand final tickets. Don't believe in never if you want to get a ticket. Head to finals.afl.com four tickets. Boomer, you'd get a few. You played 800 games.
Yeah, that's what happens when you're a life member of the AFL.
How many do you get?
No, you just get the two.
Ah, very nice. The TAC. TAC is set to continue a new venture for the TAC and young drivers. Last month, the TAC launched this new $55 million Road to Zero Experience Centre at the Melbourne Museum. Road to Zero will be built in the curriculum for all Year 9 and Year 10 students, which is fabulous and is now open to the public. For more information, visit towardszero.vic.gov.au. And as I said off the top, the Dandenong Stingrays are now the premiers.
Yeah, they were awesome yesterday. It was great to see them get up. Oakley came with a bang, but didn't quite get there. Matty Rowell, best on ground, 31 touches as a bottom major. Great effort.
Well done. And this show wouldn't be available without all our great partners. I'm going to read through. And the Builders Academy Australia, fantastic. Kangan Institute, McDonald's, Advanced Hair, Tobin Brothers Funerals, Sheen Dometic, the Melbourne Parkview Hotel. These two men here, all the cameramen, all the sound people, everybody does makeup, everybody here in the building that makes this show go to air. Thank you very much and hope you've had a great season. Thank you.